My first name is, you have to act like you're clearing your throat. So my first name is Michiel. Which I know for large parts of the population of this planet is out of reach. But trust me, I'm equally struggling with some of your names, as you can imagine. Happy to be here to begin with. It's a pleasure and an honor. And like I think it has already been mentioned, we as TNM, we really appreciate to get a bit closer to the academia, to students, to lecturers. We think we have something to offer, and we also think we have something to learn from you, from the people working at the university, and we think we should work closer together. I'm going to tell something which, let's say, I've been asked to make use of what I told before, to a large extent, at the conference of the CIM, of which the universally acclaimed president is here, Mr. Banda. I've learned at first when I entered into this beautiful country, I thought that everyone who's called Banda is related to your first president. But then later I found out that I was before at the SIM, which I enjoy too, at a bit of a smaller group. So I have to apologize to the few people that were there too, like Mr. Banda. I've even seen one or two colleagues of mine. Those two, I've been preaching to them, and some of the preaching might repeat itself. Sorry for that. But I still hope to be able to entertain and intrigue most of you to sharing some of my views, some of my experiences, and what have you. And I may be employed by TNM, which I'm happy with, but I'm not here talking on behalf of TNM. I'm also not talking about TNM. I intend to talk about marketing in general, and then specifically about the type of marketing that I've done, that I've had most exposure to, which I think, let's say, did most for my thinking, and which I think is, might be one of the best ways to look at marketing from a business perspective, but also the type of marketing that would help us as a company, and my guess is also many of you, would help you going forward in, considering the way the world is developing. The world is going digital. Now, Malawi is not at the forefront, but I will state and try to substantiate that many things that are happening are very likely to happen in Malawi too, for the simple reason that Malawians are not very different from other people, especially not in the way that you think, I think, will deal with digital stuff. But that's what I'm going to talk about. And now I'm going to pick up a piece of technology. You know how it is with technology and demonstrations. Look, the picture top left is the interesting city of Rotterdam in the country, the Netherlands, which is about the size of your lake. That's where I come from. Rotterdam is an interesting piece of architecture, mainly because our neighbors, the Germans, decided to flatten the city in 1940. It was completely bombarded away from this planet. There was nothing left. So it was rebuilt, and it's architecturally interesting. I studied in Delft. I have a master in applied mathematics, which may not sound like marketing, and that's true, but I'll try to explain where the two meet. I also studied economics. I worked mostly for telecoms companies and media companies. Orange is was back then an English company, very innovative in the way that they dealt with telecommunications. For instance, you know, and really from a marketing perspective, in Orange it was absolutely forbidden in any sort of marketing communications to show a phone. It was forbidden. Or to show prices was also forbidden. All of the marketing communications in the early days of Orange was about happy people. People that got a better life because they had better means of communications. The future is bright. The future is Orange, was the strapline. It's very innovative because in those days, telecoms marketing was very instrumental. It was about numbers of minutes, prices, speed, technical quality, that sort of stuff. I learned a lot from about it, and I would argue that many companies could still have a way to go, and I would even say, if I may, even T&M, there's some lessons to be learned from that type of marketing, which I learned at Orange. I worked for a small company that became part of AT&T. AT&T is one of the biggest telecoms companies in the world. It's impressive and also slightly boring. KPN is the T&M of the Netherlands. And I witnessed some things there which I think I can still use. And part of my view on digital marketing started with Orange. We had something like 7 million customers at KPN. And after a couple of years, we actually made a P&L for each of those 7 million customers. We had 7 million P&Ls, which allowed us to extreme detail to profile customers, to predict their churn behavior. Churn? Term known? Is it typical telecom churn? Churn is the customers that leave. So the churn percentage is a very important KPI in all telecoms companies. I've worked in companies where the churn was below 10%. That means that less than 10% of the customers per year step out. But I've also worked at a company where the churn was 45%, which I think you can imagine is just absolutely disastrous. That means that every 2 years or so, your whole customer base is gone. And you're all the time busy getting in new customers, and that company doesn't exist anymore. It might not surprise you. Endemol. I was a board member at Endemol. Try to work for a company where you really enjoy the product. Endemol was the biggest television producer back then, making programs like Deal or No Deal. But Endemol became big and rich by inventing the format Big Brother, which you might have seen, Big Brother. It's absolutely terrible and very successful. They were the inventors of reality television. I worked for Sanoma, which is a relatively large media company in Europe, active in 12 countries, mostly magazines, newspapers, and some television, in some countries really big online. And I've been a couple of times in my life in transitional situations where the market, the company, and so on suddenly dramatically changed. I would like to say that you know, that you might say there is a pattern in my career, but I can confess I've never looked for that. I've been surprised and actually almost overrun a couple of times. I worked at Sanoma when the big financial crisis in Europe started, and Sanoma mainly relied on revenues from magazines. Not quite sure how it is here, but in Europe, magazines are mostly bought and read by women, and advertising is a very important revenue source for magazines. That completely crashed. It was an absolute nightmare, and we were active in 12 countries, big company, a big learning experience. But my God, what a bloodbath! It was terrible. We came back, by the way, later, mainly through digital. Sanoma also has hundreds of sites and apps, which back then started to grow. Thank God. I worked briefly for Aegon. who put me into Asia, in Indonesia, Singapore, China, India, to develop business for them. One of the interesting things that Aegon did is they created a bank, which is 100% online, and which does not create most of its own products. They are an aggregator, so they offer loans from another bank, mortgages from another bank, insurances from another company, but they all bundle it. And I will come back to this theme. In the digital world, having the customer relationship, or as some people say, the customer ownership. I have my doubts about the term ownership, but managing the customer relationship, and especially if you have all, if you can profile the customer, if you have all the data about his or her transactions, then that gives you a significant amount of insight into the behavior of the customer, but it also gives you a certain element of power, and it creates a trust relationship. Once you have paid a bill to someone only once or twice, it becomes much easier to charge amounts to that same person because a relationship of trust has been settled. And that's what the bank called Knop. Knop is a rather bad word joke, you know, bank Knop, did. It's quite interesting concept. I worked for a company called Smile, which is a 4G operator in Nigeria. I think I already knew it, but ever since I've landed here, that was my time at Smile in Nigeria. I went back to Europe for a short time. I became CEO of an artificial intelligence company that makes chatbots. Then I ended up at T&M, which I've started 6 months ago. In Europe, people pay through the nose for educational books. I'm not sure how it is here, but in Europe, that is a very profitable business. Educational books for primary, secondary, and your type of education. That model is being broken down by all sorts of digital stuff, all sorts of online things. Let me check. Khan's Academy. K-H-A-N. Does it mean anything? No. Khan is it's a really fascinating example of something that you might call disruptive. You know, disruption is a bit of a cliche, but Khan is a guy of Indian origin, I believe, but he's American. And he was an engineer in Silicon Valley, and his cousins in New York had a difficulty with mathematics and physics, you know, little kids they were. And then example close to home, we at T&M, we used to spend a lot of money on education, we still do, but these days most of the education that we do is through Udemy. Not sure whether you know it, Udemy is 100% online, and you have Coursera. And that education, and this is not meant as a threat to the wonderful, excellent Catholic University, but even for institutes like this, that type of education, it can be, let's say, complementary, but it can also compete. You know, and I know in my country, all universities, they record all lectures, and there are students, who hardly go to lectures anymore, they just follow it online, but they can also pick and choose. They can also do one lecture from that university, and one from that, and one from, let's say, in the US. I tend to think it's a great thing for humanity. But that happens more often in digital stuff. What is really good for the consumer might actually be very bad for the establishment that provides it. That's close to home too. But it's an interesting phenomenon. Anyway, the good news is I think you're all way too young to even have a... My guess is that you hardly know how it was, which is good. So you don't have a legacy. The book on the right used to be really the standard book by Mr. Kotler. And the photograph on the left is of a television series called Mad Men. If you haven't seen it, I would honestly recommend it. It's about old-style marketing. And I put up a couple of words over there. It's very much about brands. All of the communications is broadcast, so same message to everyone. It's there's no interaction whatsoever. It's all television, radio, and billboards. And it's very much about creative advertising. This started in the 60s or so in the US, and I would argue that you still see elements of that across the planet, also in Malawi. I'm not saying it's bad, but I think some things can be much better, smarter, and this has become much smaller. I would also recommend to watch the television series, Mad Men. It's very American, very enjoyable, and it also paints a picture of offices in the 60s with almost endless, unlimited smoking and drinking in office hours. Isn't that wonderful? Then whatever is digital is non-rival. Practicality of that is, if you have one book, it can be read by one person at the same time. But if a book is digitized in whatever form, it can be read and used by a million people at the same time, or by 10 million people, without any extra costs. This is essential for everything that you do in a digital way. And on top of that, if you copy a digital thing, the copying itself costs almost nothing, and there's no quality loss. Think about doing that with a physical book. This is not about books, but whether it's about books or advertising or services, you know that perfectly well, many of the videos that you watch come from the other side of the planet. The first one who came up with this idea is the guy right on top, Mr. Negroponte. That book is very old, but I would argue it's still worth reading. Well, what happened in digital from the left to the right? My guess is that most of you have not seen the two pictures on the left. It's an old IBM PC and the first Apple. But I'm 56. I've seen them all. And even before that. And then there were mobile phones, Wi-Fi, all that sort of, the fiber. And now we have these, it's just a couple of the big players. I think you know them. But this country relies much more on Facebook, for instance, than I'm used to in other countries. And you tend to use much fewer websites. Anyway, this is all, you know it. This is all happening and has a huge impact. Another thing I want to touch upon is what is called the long tail. Well, the guy who came up with this concept, Mr. Anderson, has observed some time ago that in digital you can actually do things which he says are in the long tail. The long tail is on the right of that picture. The left, now the vertical axis shows the amount of usage, so to say. So on the left you could say that's the top 10 of records which have high usage. But if you go further to the right, you see the ones with very little usage. There are, if you look at an online record store, there are tracks, Afro, Acid, Cuban, Jazz. It's a very niche type of music, probably made in Cuba, but even that I don't know. By the way, in Cuba they don't have internet. The thing is, can you have a shop, whether it's in Blantyre or in Rotterdam or in New York, a physical shop selling or focusing on Afro, Acid, Cuban, Jazz. Now, what that also comes with, that in turn leads to unbundling. One example which I was part of, magazines and newspapers are bundled products. In a magazine you'll find, let's say, 30 articles, and most people only want to read 3 or 4. But you pay for all 30. Same for a newspaper. There's no one who reads a whole newspaper. No one. But you pay for it a lot. What unbundling does is that in those niches, it addresses people who only want to read 1 or 2 articles. By the way, a book you cannot unbundle. You are not going to sell a book in separate chapters. But a newspaper, a magazine, a record, but also all sorts of other services, like a television, a broadcast channel, you can also unbundle it. Because you can buy a movie here and a documentary there, and you can look up your news here. So it's unbundling and then bundling again. This is all possible in the digital world. It's actually practically impossible in a physical world. If you have physical physical magazines or newspapers or let's say everything physical is hardly unbundleable. But in digital, everything is unbundleable. There's a couple of companies there which are, some of them are payment providers, which is about unbundling of banking. In the old days, it was absolutely impossible to begin your own television channel. It's just not possible. It's too expensive, too complicated. Also, you need licenses and all that sort of stuff. But with YouTube or TikTok or Instagram, you can make your own stuff, and before you know it, the whole world can watch it. TikTok is a very interesting example. Many things I talk about may have been started in the US, Silicon Valley. I predict that in the next 10 years, many more things will come out of China, leading things. And that, for instance, WeChat is much more interesting as a company than Facebook. And the way they use all sorts of, the way they aggregate all sorts of unbundled services is impressive. There are people who have argued that Google, for every search action that you type in, that Google should pay you one kwacha. And I think that's fundamentally correct. I'm not here to talk about Google or about their business model, but they make piles of money, which, and I you know, I think Google is a blessing for the world, but they make money on gathering data that you provide. And not just a bit. And that data then in turn is used by others. Because I'm not sure how technical you are. Anyone here who knows what cookies are? Cookies? Cookies? Not the cookies you eat. Websites and apps put in your browser. It, let's say in my country, anyone who uses the internet gets 100 cookies per day, hundreds, upon which people can build a very detailed profile. One of the companies I worked for, my little country has 17 million people too, just like you, and we had profiles of 11 million people. We didn't even know their names, but we didn't care. All of these things, you know, what you click on or what you don't click on, your location, Wi-Fi networks have very detailed location information. And there's, I can go on, whatever you like, whoever you might be swiping left or right on Tinder. The conversation content, of course, is subject to privacy. There's very few people who know who you talk, what you discuss over the phone, or what you type in WhatsApp. WhatsApp doesn't know it, TNM doesn't know it, and I can promise we'll never know it, and we don't even want to know it. So the fact that I, every night, for 3/4 of an hour, have a phone call with someone who lives there, and that someone has a certain Facebook profile and is friends with him and with him, the combination of all that sort of data says a lot about the profile of a person, even about the political preferences or the likelihood that that person will buy a certain car. All that sort of things is actually not so difficult to gather. And then if you have the conversational metadata, so when does the certain conversation takes place, again, TNM, it's in the TNM systems. We don't use it. And the books on the right, I want to mention that too, those are books that are quite critical on this digital economy. You see, Attention Merchants, pretty good book, actually, and The Age of Surveillance Capitalism. And that lady states that by all sorts of surveillance on your behavior, that people make money on that, and that they actually can manipulate you, that they can predict your behavior, and that they use that for commercial benefits. I personally think the book from Ms. Shuboff is overly critical, but that's a view. You can have a discussion on it. But fundamentally, she has a point. There are people making money by extracting data from you on you. Which, if I talk for myself, I roughly know what sort of data is being gathered about me, and I've come to the conclusion that I don't really care. But some people do care, and I also think that the topic of privacy deserves a better discussion than it gets now. In most countries, including Malawi, including my home country, there's hardly any discussion on these matters. It's a really difficult topic. But back to the point, all of these things, up to the level, the type of food that you order, it does say something about your personality. And the combination of all of these touch points, if you just keep gathering data, e-commerce, I'm not sure whether you use Amazon already. I'm a big user of Amazon. And Amazon has launched, let's say, Amazon-branded commodity products. You know, boring stuff. Really boring stuff. Underpants, socks, batteries, napkins. Little things you need on a regular basis. Do you know that they paid $1 billion for nappies.com? Because they can predict when mothers need stuff for their babies and that sort of stuff, and it's a big market. It's not cost sensitive. If you need stuff for your baby, you want it now, and you don't care what it costs. And these are things that most people don't appreciate going out for. You just want to get it done. You know, nobody says, this is a wonderful day. I'm going to enjoy buying new underwear. It's not going to happen. And they take away that inconvenience. But it's all based on data. Data, data, data. And in several countries and economies, the amounts of data that are being gathered through these and other touch points are massive. But even before the digital stuff happened or happens, people, including me, that our brain is not wired for exponential effects. It's true. Because if I do this 50 times, it will be bloody difficult, but it will go beyond the moon. That's what an exponential thing is. It just gets completely, goes through the roof. My point being, that's what happened to computers. And it's still happening. They still double every 2 years or so. So the amount of processing power that we have on the planet is immense, and it keeps on growing and at a more than linear pace. Where someone discovered that his wife was pregnant because of the advertising on their computer. And the advertising was all about pregnancy because she had done several things. She had done search actions and ordered something, you know, pregnancy test or whatever. It's actually very straightforward. And it's also, you can imagine, from a privacy perspective, it's a bit peculiar. I'll give you one other example. In my country, they have been able to predict flu waves. You know, your malaria is our flu, so to say. It's something that you get now and then, no escape. But from search actions, mostly done by parents, they've been able to predict flu waves and how they go through the country because of people doing searches for coughing, headaches, and all that sort of stuff. The thing is, those things, other things, can bring you to very targeted advertising. Some people don't like it, but I think the best counter argument is that targeted online advertising also implies that I do not get advertising for, let's say, female beauty products. That, you know, the relevance of the whole environment gets bigger. But you can also imagine that the commercial conversion, so to say, the commercial success gets much better. Churn prediction, I already mentioned the term churn. If you gather a lot of data, and let me give you the example of a company like ours, if we know that someone lives in an area where the network has had some difficulties, if that same person has called twice or three times to customer service to complain or whatever, if that person is a bit late with recharging, if the usage of that person is going down, all of these things we can see. It's very likely that that person is a dissatisfied customer and may be looking to go to another provider. And then that's just a straightforward analysis. If you do, let's say, elements of machine learning on that sort of data, you can be even better and smarter in the way that you predict behavior. This is all possible today and tomorrow. The company I used to be part of that does chatbots uses elements of AI, quite simple AI, but still difficult enough for most people, for me too. But from the conversations that we had, and we had, let's say, several million conversations per day done by a machine instead of a living person, it appeared that, you know, many conversations can be done by machines. If it's about a simple complaint, people say, I want to move, I want to have a different bank account, I want to have this, I want to have that. Simple things can be easily done by machines. What we did with those conversations also is that we analyzed all of the conversations, which helped us to predict how those conversations would go, because we could see that after a certain question or a certain type of feedback, it was very likely that that type of question or that type of feedback would follow. So we could model the conversations accordingly, making them better and better and better. I was talking about churn prediction and lifetime value management. With that I mean that I think that a company like ours, but also a bank, but also an e-commerce company, that they can look at how long a customer stays, how long a customer is likely to stay based on certain statistics, and how what sort of spending that customer does with what sort of margin. You can run the whole customer lifetime analysis in your systems, and then I'll give you an example. If a customer hardly spends anything, and you can see the signals suggesting that that customer might be leaving, then you say, so what? If it's a low-value customer, and I don't mean that to be in an unfriendly manner, but just from a commercial perspective, some customers are much more valuable than others. So, and that's also, for instance, is what I preach in T&M. If a high-value customer shows signs of dissatisfaction, so that plays a role in there too. You know, you can differentiate your approaches. For some customers, you should be providing royal service. And for some other customers, you might say, well, we'll see about that tomorrow. But I do think that it is fair to distinguish between customers, just like someone in a normal shop, you know, a little shop where the owner knows all the customers there too. They will differentiate between the different types of customers. You can do that in an online environment too. That saves you a lot of money. Customer acquisition. I'm a skeptic on classical market research, and what I think is that in digital atmospheres, you can try things out. Example, and I did it, you can offer people some sort of a package, you know, whatever service it is, and some people you offer it at 100 kwacha, and some other people at 90 kwacha. You do it all at the same time, each offer goes out 100 times, and then you see how it goes, and after 2 days or something, you know exactly which offer goes down best and what the exact price elasticity is. I would like to share my favorite experience with market research, and this is to ridicule market researchers, especially if you ask for something that people don't really know, you get almost useless answers. I was involved in market research, well, maybe before some of you were born, which is a depressing thing, but into mobile telephony. And then before it really was known, and we asked people, do you want to be reachable if you're in line at the grocery or something like that? And back then, of course, almost everyone said no, because they had no view of mobile telephony. It wasn't known. The outcome of the market research, classical market research, was that 98% of the people were not interested in mobile telephony. So the outcome was there was actually no market for mobile telephony, which sounds weird, and it is weird. I mean, that appeared to be terribly, terribly wrong. But that is what market research can do. If you ask for certain things and people don't know it,
or they don't want to know it. I think you also know, the more products that you sell to people, the closer the relationship gets with your customer base. This goes for telecoms companies, it goes for banks, it even goes for retailers. If you sell more, they will be more loyal. It's more, much less likely that they go out, but also the revenue per customer goes up. I know this sounds very quantitative, but this works. Sentiment analysis, not sure whether it happens here, but I am sure that social media are big here. And I was involved in a company that used social media to analyze the sentiment about certain brands or products. If it's big enough, you have to have some volume, but then you can check how people perceive the launch of a certain product or what their general perception is of a brand. You can determine whether it's positive, negative, how it moves within a certain scale. And that is because all the data is there. It's all open, it's all free. You can pick it up and you can analyze it. It's quite a big thing, sentiment analysis. And again, another phenomenon that makes classical market research, in my view, almost obsolete. This is an article which it was in the Financial Times about how to predict certain tastes. It's about food and drinks and whatever. I don't have time to get into it now. If you want to read it, send me a mail. The Financial Times is behind a paywall, but I know a way to go around that. I haven't said that, but I'll get you the article if you want. It's about using data to predict what sort of drinks or soups or that sort of stuff, what people with a different profile, what they are, what you can expect them to like. The nice things about benefits, and the guy on the right, you may or may not know him, but this is sort of quote that has been ascribed to many people. He, long time ago, said, I know that about half of what I spend on marketing is wasted. Unfortunately, I don't know which half. But my thing is that if you do elements of digital marketing, you can generally calculate the exact return for every campaign that you do. Even very small campaigns, you can see, this is what I spent. I approached these customers. We had a conversion of 3%, and that created customers with a value of this and this and that. So you can just calculate the whole thing. It's not always 100%, but very often close to it. I strongly advocate that method. You can also do things that are invisible in digital marketing. If you use Facebook, for instance, and you would argue Facebook is out in the open, but it's not true. The offers that I get on Facebook are very different from the offers that you get, or she gets. It's practically invisible for other for competitors, but you can even do offers, and I've done that. I can make a much better offer to him than I can give to you, for reasons that, because I want him, I have more interest to get him in as a customer than you, because of your profile, maybe your income or whatever, which you could, in a shop, you can't say, this cake or whatever, I'll give it to you for 100 kwacha, but you, I'll charge 200 kwacha. In my country, for instance, airlines, travel agents in my country have been almost all dead. It has gone completely online. But what you can see now and then, and it's very hard to detect because it's very smartly done, but people who try to book travel through an Apple computer almost always get a higher price charged than people that do it through a Windows computer. You can try things. In the media company I worked for, one of the things we had was a large news site, really large, a couple of billion of views per month. And we did A/B testing, as in every article that went out, it got two titles, two headers. And one of them went to 50% of the people, random, and the other title went to the other 50%. So if they clicked on the article, he got a different header than you. And then we checked which created more reading time and which got clicked through on the advertising more. The impact was quite significant. We played around that with titles, with photographs and whatever. And it was constant testing, trying, which online people call A-B testing. You can try out all sorts of things. You can just try it with 100 people and then see how it goes in digital spheres. Continuous improvement, it's not about, you know, making one big thing, but in digital spheres you make things. There's a concept which you may or may not know, the minimum viable product. That comes from the agile school of thinking. You bring a product on the market as soon as you can, and you know it's not perfect, but from then on, you just keep improving it, and you also get in feedback from the customers, and you actually tell them, this product is not done, it's not finished, we're trying it out. It works. You can scale things, a digital product at least, or digital advertising for that matter, digital marketing. Whether you do it for 100 people or 1,000 people, the price difference is generally not that big. And I forgot to mention, if you look at Facebook or Google or Instagram, all that sort of things, you may have tried it. Advertising on these media, you can actually start with $10, which in television, newspapers, magazines, radio is completely impossible. You can start with very small amounts and then scale it up. You can look if it works. Or like I said, you can try 4 different campaigns. You look at it for a week, and then the best one you pick out, and you do it times 10. Then you throw money at the thing that really makes the needle move. Not understanding things, I mean, you can try things out, and if there are certain correlations or causality, I've seen that certain things were not even that explainable, that we saw that certain actions came with a very high conversion and we couldn't even explain it. But so what? If it works, it works. If you don't have a very, very convincing explanation, I would say, I don't care. If it works, I'm fine with it. And this happened to me more than once in elements of digital marketing. Return on investment, I've already mentioned. I'm going to glance very quickly over this, but this is a relatively new type of insights. It's called behavioral economics. It, in my view, it completely undermines economics. As you may know, economics is the theory of economy is based on assumptions as in that markets are transparent, that all players in the markets have full information, and that they all act rationally to maximize their utility function. People don't have full information, they don't even want to, and people don't behave rational. None of you behaves rational all the time. Neither do I. The book on the right is slightly easier. The book on the left is semi-academic. The right one, Ariely, also has some really nice videos. Really nice. I recommend them. It's about what he calls predictably. He says, you know, people are very irrational, but the good news is it's very predictable. And it's true. He works with stuff like pricing. He has many examples which are in the commercial realm. I actually insist that people who work in the way people perceive pricing and how you can influence them is to a large extent based on insights from books like these. I have to watch my time. There is, of course, if you take all this digital stuff, you do run in technology, and the last statement on expectations versus reality, a word of warning, people expect miracles from technology, and that is very often not true. The guy on the right there once said that the short-term expectations on about technology are usually way too high. The view on the impact of technology is too big. People expect miracles, but he said the view on technology in the longer run actually often underestimates the impact of that technology. So people think it's going to work a miracle today, but that's not true. The miracle won't happen today, but some really important things might happen over time. I tend to think that applies to many of the technologies that are now coming up, whether it's AI or whatever. One moment, let me say a couple of words. What I find interesting about this guy, he's very old. By the way, he was also very Catholic. He used to go to Mass twice a day. He didn't read any academic books, and he hardly used media. But he's called Marshall McLuhan. He wrote some really interesting books about media. They're very, very old, but I think they're still quite valid. Decades ago, he already said that information technology will make people work together, talk together, what have you, all over the planet, irrespective of where they are, because of electronic means will make people communicate and trade and what have you.
Unaware of new environments, because they're afraid of them. From the moment of birth, people are sense that the environment, the new environment around them, is hostile. It's a real threat to their whole existence.
In companies, you will find older people. And I honestly say now and then, you know, for some things we need a bunch of people of 20, 25 years old, because they're more likely to show the skills and the behaviors listed there. By the way, I'm not saying that people should show cannibalism. With cannibalism, I mean that in a company like us, but in many big companies, you should also be willing to eat your own revenues. But what happens often if new activities, new digital activities in a company start, that they go at the cost of the old stuff. And the worst you can do is, no, don't start anything new that might endanger our main revenue stream. This is a very common thing in companies, and it's very dangerous and very stupid and also very human. It's all described in the left book, The Innovator's Dilemma, which states that big companies with a solid revenue line and a good position and a great brand and whatever, that for them it is so hugely difficult to develop new things because it very often comes with what he calls cannibalistic things. I think it's true. I've seen it many times. In the magazine and newspaper company where I worked, we developed sites that just became bigger and bigger and bigger, and the revenues of the old things started to decline. That leads to all sorts of responses in a big company that are very difficult to manage. And I'll tell you, in T&M too, we make most of our money on telephony, on voice, but we should be moving towards data, and that will, at a certain moment in time, also go at the cost of our voice and revenues. My simple perspective on that is, I don't care. As long as we keep growing in data, we'll manage the rest. Let me mention one other thing, which is not here, which is about quality. Digital stuff tends to be perceived as of less quality. You may or may not know the name Kodak, photos, photography. They kept saying that digital photography is bad quality. They kept saying that, and they're bankrupt now. At the end of the day, many people don't really care about quality. If it's good enough, if it's affordable, if it works, people are very okay with accepting a bit less quality. Very different business. I talked about scale, about local stuff. I don't know Malawi enough, but there's a cultural thing. In my country, 85%, my home country, I should say, I mean, I work here, I live here, so this is my country now, but the country where I came from, 85% of the content on YouTube that we Dutch people consume, 85% is non-Dutch. My point is, the local markets might be completely swallowed by international markets. Not all people like that. For instance, there are countries where they actively push back, or they even put in laws. In France, they insist that every medium has at least, I think, 50% or so French content, and they, for instance, tend to forbid certain words and terms if they're not French. But I'm not sure how it's going to happen here, but my guess is here too, that there will be, the things might become less local. And that also ties into the way you market. Because if people consume other types of content, they have other experience, it might influence their thinking, but it might also mean that you have other ways to advertise through international content and whatever. These are platforms, that's what they're called these days, very powerful, massive scale, and network effects, because the more apartments there are on offer on Airbnb, the more attractive it becomes for me to be a customer looking for an apartment, and the more customers are looking for an apartment, the more it becomes attractive for apartment owners to put their apartment on Airbnb. These are things that reinforce each other. But on Booking.com, which you may or may not know, it's one of the biggest travel things on the planet. Once, as a hotel, you get, let's say, 20-30% of your revenues through Booking.com, you're locked in. They have you by the balls. You can't go out anymore. And this is happening in several digital platforms. Think about it. If you're the platform, it's a nice to have. If you're not the platform, you should be careful to not become too dependent on that type of things. Because you will be able to find most news online. And then if I look up the newspapers here, they have a lot of what I call classifieds, advertising for cars, homes, dates. I've done some research Saturday. I looked at the advertising, women seeking men and men seeking women. And I noticed that especially in the men seeking women, there's phone numbers and that T&M was overrepresented. Not sure what it means, but there were more numbers of men seeking women with an 88 number. Classifieds, all classifieds will go online just because it's better, cheaper, faster. I have nothing against newspapers, on the contrary, but the value destruction of the old classified business in many other countries has been massive. I mean, absolutely massive. All of the technological, of many of the things I've touched upon are technologically driven, and I honestly think that we're sort of at the... There was a very interesting video by Benedict Evans, if you want to see him, I can send it to you. And he talked about the end of the beginning. This was about the internet. He said, this is sort of the end of the beginning of widespread use of internet. It will go much, much further, but what has happened now is that the easy things, like classifieds, have been digitized. Many technologies are there or growing very, very fast. Self-driving cars, face recognition. That on the top right is the Amazon store in Seattle. There's no staff in the store. There's also no cashier. You pick up things and you go home, and let's say 5 seconds after you've left the shop, you get the bill through your Amazon account. With cameras and tactile sensors and whatever, it has been exactly determined which products you took. And by the way, on the basis of your Amazon profile, it can also predict what you take. And for instance, if you would try to commit fraud, I would argue it would be very easy for them to detect fraud if you would make certain transactions that are completely against the grain of your consumer profile. It's a fascinating store. I recommend it. And this is, what was he called again? Kurzweil, who is slightly mad, but it's interesting. He goes even further in saying that in the next 20, 30, or 40 years, the total amount of machine intelligence on this planet will be bigger than the total amount of human intelligence. That's an outrageous point of view. But if you read the book, I would argue you still start, you start wondering, it might be partly true. I'm not here to talk about him or the other things, but I do mean that the impact of technology will only grow, and probably grow big time. And process analytics is likely to grow even more. Why, or what does it mean for Malawi? And I'm not here to criticize your country. On the contrary, it's a beautiful and nice country, but in some ways, not at the forefront of development. The broadband penetration is low. Electricity comes with certain challenges. affordability is an issue. You know, for us, one of the biggest hurdles is that a 4G smartphone is something that for most Malawians is not very much in reach. It's a big issue for us. In some circles, there's not a big pool. People are not screaming and shouting, I want internet or I want a smartphone. At least in some segments, they're not. And the funny thing, one of the key statements in the book is people in other, in, let's say, in lesser developed areas on the planet are, once they can get their hands on internet, they really want it. And then there was the view that people who are, let's say, some of them might be poor, and the view was poor people will use internet to find healthcare for their children, to educate themselves, and to, you know, to improve their lives in an instrumental and economical fashion. She strongly disagrees with that picture. She says and explains, poor people want to see cat videos. No, and she has pretty strong proof for that. That the behavior of people who are just about to meet the internet, you know, today or tomorrow morning, that they will largely focus on entertainment or on dating, on that sort of things, and much less so on instrumental ways to improve their lives. Anyway, I would argue Malawians are not different, and that pretty much everything, or almost everything, what I've talked about is likely to be relevant. Not necessarily all of it tomorrow morning, maybe not all of it, but all of these digital things are likely to happen in a specific Malawian manner, which I also cannot completely predict. But the large development is likely to happen here, and that will bring really interesting opportunities for different ways of marketing that are actually better than the old style marketing, because it's measurable, it's predictable, you can calculate the return, and so on and so on. This is a summary of what I've already said. Should I want to mention once more privacy. I've noticed in several countries that younger people are generally less sensitive for privacy matters. I'm not saying that you should. Privacy is something that people should at least be able to protect, or they should be able to influence what others can do with their personal data. This is really difficult, but think about it. For now, I hope this is of interest to you, that you picked up some ideas. And let me say, you know, again, we appreciate, we're not here to sell T&M, or not at all, but we like to learn from you. In all of this, what I've told, this is important for the way that we develop as a company. And if you're really into this, or think that you might have a career ahead of you in that type of business, in the very analytical marketing, then who knows? You know, we're interested to get in touch with smart people, young people, to bring this and related things further.
I'm from social sciences. Now, when you talk up, we're talking about digital marketing. My interest is in the jobs that we are creating or we are losing from the old marketing. You haven't talked about that in your presentation, but I saw the picture you presented on Amazon and the shop that doesn't have any stuff in it. What happens to jobs with digital marketing? What is happening to the issue of employment with digital marketing?
The first wave of digitization very often takes out the middleman. People who play a role in getting certain transactions done. I mentioned travel agents, and there's sales positions. If it's
an article that is easily to trade online, and you don't really need human intervention, or that human intervention doesn't add a lot of value, then it's very likely to be pushed out. You know, a word that is sometimes used is disintermediation. You know, things that are really easy to bypass and which offer products that people are quite happy to buy online, at night, whatever, and where also the people can configure their own product themselves, like in travel. But most people tend to think that in 20, 30 years, lots of the individual traffic and even more of the transport traffic will be displaced by intelligent vehicles. I tend to think so too.
Like marketers get information through conversation contents. So I wanted to ask, in terms of TNM, does that mean that you listen to the conversations of the people that make calls? And if that's the case, isn't that a breach to privacy?
The conversations themselves, some of them you can follow, I would argue. For instance, certain conversations on Twitter are completely public. Agree? If people say something and others respond and you get these threads and this and that, that's all very public and nothing stops you from picking them up. Phone conversations are protected. Telecoms companies tend to not go to the what we call the application layer. We provide connectivity between you and a server there, or between you and your friends, or between you and the WhatsApp platform. That's more or less where it stops. And as far as I'm concerned, we will never do that. There have been telcos who experimented with that, and A, it's technically really difficult. B, it's not our business, we're not good at it. And C, it gets into an arena where I don't want to be.
What exactly is TNM doing at the moment to ensure that they use digital marketing as a competitive advantage besides the Bamba?
What do we do to create a digital advantage? I think many things in a company like ours, it's not like you can buy a system or do something simple and then have a sustainable competitive advantage. That's not. It's hard work and being smarter than the rest. It certainly doesn't revolve around me, but I have experience in the things I talked about, and I can play a little role in there. My role is to set certain priorities and to say, you know, we're going to do this more and this less, and we're going to spend more money on what I call below the line, under the radar screen, digital marketing, and we're going to spend less money on billboards and television advertising and radio advertising and that sort of stuff. That sort of priorities I can play a role in, and then it's a matter of finding smart people. So that's also what I think I said here. You know, it also means that the profile of marketeers changes. Now, that doesn't mean that we have to that we should fire all of our marketeers tomorrow morning. We shouldn't, but it does mean that we should also get other people in, and on specifically on, for instance, Facebook marketing, and that, which I've seen to be hugely powerful. It's not just in the marketing department. I think that the things I discussed is you need commercially oriented IT people, which are difficult to find. You know, it's a cliche, but many IT people are programmers and are slightly nerdy. But you need people in information systems that really know how to create. You know, the way I tell about it is easy, but you're talking about terabytes of data flowing through our network and through our billing systems and what have you. We have some people in our technical department. Our new CTO is highly commercial in his thinking and thinks about what sort of people do what sort of usage for what sort of thing on which sites, which day, which hour of the day, in which locations. You have to have people who think in a different way. I'm optimistic as to how many people over the next 2 to 3 years will start little
internet businesses. Some of them might fail, some of them might die, but there is room. There is room, and Malawians are traders to some extent. It will happen.
And thank you very much. And I understand my principles of account, principles of marketing students. The language might be very technical. I'll try to simplify it for you so that at least you still get your 25 marks. It's still there because we had a lot of topics which are related to what we have covered, and then we should be able to ask each other questions. But I'll simplify that. For the rest of the team, I would say thank you very much to my dean, to the Faculty of Commerce, the Director of Research and Publications, who have more lectures like this from TNM. This is not the end, this is the beginning. They have other areas of expertise which they can impact on us, and we'll form a partnership with them, and we'll forge ahead on that. I would like to say thank you very much to everybody else. Unless there are other programs which is after, that is when we have released everybody else, some people still have got some age which they want to talk to TNM, we'll allow for that. But we only allow for 10 minutes maybe for that. Thank you very much.